just taking the make the bet at the end there. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison from licklibrary.com. It is nice to be back on another webinar, this time with the subject of bending strings, but maybe not quite as fast as last time. In case you're wondering what I'm on about, last week we were here discussing vibrato. Today we are here discussing string bending. It's great to be back on with you guys. I love doing these streams, right? It's so much fun. It's lovely to hear from you guys and chat to you about guitar playing. It's one of my favorite things to do. It becomes a highlight of my week every time I get to do one. So thanks for coming on board. I want to take a quick second to give a shout out to all of our Lick Library members who are here. If you are not a Lick Library member, that's cool. We're glad to have you on board too. But we got a whole bunch of good stuff for you that I'll talk to you about as we go further. But you may consider picking up a Lick Library membership along the way, because man, we got some good stuff that's going to help with the stuff that we're talking about this evening. So anyway, a little quick thing. If you are getting some use out of what we're doing on these streams, just want to remind you that a couple of ways you can help us reach as many guitar players as we possibly can with these streams and spread the good word about string bending and how it's supposed to be done, then you can do the following. You can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you happen to be watching on. If it's YouTube, you can hit the like button. If it's Facebook, you can hit the love button. The algorithm absolutely loves that love icon, seconded only by the angry icon. So if the string bends make you angry, hey, hit that button too. It all helps, but we prefer the love icon because we're all about positivity here. So other ways, you can drop us a comment. We love to hear from you guys. If you have questions, don't forget, you can drop those in the comments. We would absolutely love to hear from you. So whatever questions you have at any point this evening, drop them in the comments. I will try my best to answer them as we go on. We've got about 45 minutes together, so before we get too lost in the weeds, let's just take a quick second and say hello to everybody who's in the chat. First through the door is Kate Strange. Kate is one of our one-to-one students that we have, or one-to-one members that we have at licklibrary.com. Kate's taken one-to-one sessions with Stuart Shields, who is in the chat. But did you know, if you're a Lick Library member, you are entitled to take these one-to-one lessons. It's no extra charge. It's part of your membership. So if you've got questions, you want to jump on a call and chat to somebody about it, we have our man, Stu Shields, who is in the comments this evening. We'd love to hear from you. So once you're done with this stream, if there's anything you want clarified, or you just want some help selecting lessons going forward, talk to Stu. He's there to give you some one-to-one guidance on licklibrary.com. Kate, it's great to see you. Keith MOF is over from the other channel. Keith, it's lovely to see you. It's been about 2 days. Saw Keith on Monday on the streams that we're doing over on the Guitar Interactive channel. So if you guys want to join us on Mondays, you know where to find us. Block 18 is in the house. Hey, Keith. Hey, Kate. Looking forward to this. I'm looking forward to this too. Who else do we have? Keith MOF has a Strat at the ready. Great choice, my man. I feel like I need to add another Strat to my arsenal. I've got my Silver Sky over there. I don't think that counts, but recently dropped a review of the Maybach Stradivari. You guys can see I'm playing this Maybach Convair today. This is my new favorite guitar. That Stradivari is pretty special though, so I might need to pick one of those up. Strats are great. We love them. Alan Brooker is in the house. Alan, lovely to see you. Looking forward to this. I'm looking forward to it too, man. Helmet Strap is here. Says, hey everyone, looking forward to another great lesson. Man, appreciate you. Appreciate you coming on board. Thanks for coming. Mike says, watered, fed, and ready to go. Same. Been eating my body weight in what have I had today? KFC. I should be cutting weight because I'm trying to stay in a weight class, but even still, KFC is good. Mike says P90 Revstar. Nice choice. Those Revstars are very underrated guitars. We love them, right? I got a bunch of them at the university where I teach, and they're just the house guitars, and they're absolutely fantastic. I feel like Yamaha kind of dropped the ball on marketing those a little bit, and maybe they should have been more popular than they are, but that's another story for another day. Alan Brooke is playing PRS Mark Holcomb SE. We like a bit of PRS, as you can see from the line of PRS sat over here. So great choice, man. Yamaha SC700 says Block 18. Very cool. Lots of love for the Yamahas in the stream this evening. They make great guitars. Steve Ford is in the house. Steve, it's good to see you. Mark Crandall is here. Who else do we have? With some more PRS action with a PRS Chris Robertson and a PRS SE Custom 24. All really beautiful guitars. Maybe I should grab my PRS. No, I'm playing the Maybach. The Maybach is nice. Anyway, who else do we have in the house? Alan Brooker, regarding his oh, bless you, that is not the intended result, but Alan Brooker is referring to his rating of his own bending skill. He would say about a 6, but looking at Nick make that a 3. Ah, oh, bless your heart, man. I'll take the compliment, but my bends don't make your bends worse, I promise. But hey, man, I appreciate the compliment. Thank you very much. Who else do we have? Let's very quickly see what's going on. I'll be stacking tunas for this webinar. Totally normal behavior. You know what? Having tuna handy is a good thing. I should have one handy too. Jim Baker is in the house. Eddie Russell is here playing his Parker Fly. JM Guitar Tuition is in the house too. Old dog here to learn new tricks. Same. JM Guitar Tuition is playing his Fender Strat with Seymour Duncan Everything Axe. Very nice. I'm guessing that's like fully loaded with Seymour Duncans, and it's not a type of Seymour Duncan pickup. If it is, I want one. Dan Oliver is playing a Gary Moore Les Paul. Great choice, and one of the best to ever bend a string. So anyway, let's get into the meat of today's session. So we're going to talk about string bending today. We're also going to talk about autofocus on Sony cameras, which apparently like my hands, but they also like my face, but that's okay. So yeah, autofocus aside, string bending, let's get into the meat of it. First of all, what are we doing with string bending? What is it for? How do we do it? Well, string bending, like our vibrato session last week, is simply the act of taking a string and stretching it. Steve I even calls this stretching strings rather than bending strings. He calls it stretching, which makes a lot more sense, I guess. But what we're basically doing is we're taking a string, we're either pushing or pulling on said string in order to tighten it as if we were tightening the tuning peg. It's a very similar process. We tighten the string, which raises its pitch. Now, in raising its pitch, we are able to create a smooth glide from one pitch to another. We can either go up, we can actually go down if we're clever about it. We can go up and down, we can go down and up. Either way, it allows us to play the guitar in a fashion that we'd refer to as portamento. Now, portamento just means gliding smoothly from one pitch to another. Let me give you a quick demonstration. We're gonna go to another sound here real quick, and we'll go to this camera so we can see what's going on. Now, we're gonna do this together very quickly, but what I wanna do is I wanna take finger number 3, we're gonna park that on fret number 11 on our G string, and we're gonna play the following, just for argument's sake. Let's try playing together. We're gonna play finger number 1 on fret number 9, finger 3 on fret number 11, and then we'll play finger number 1 on fret number 9 on our B string. So we get this. A perfectly fine way to play the first 3 notes of the major scale, but we can also do this. Now, in doing that, what I've done is I've played exactly the same 3 notes, the same 3 notes again, where we are playing our 3rd finger on fret number 11, but instead of going to fret number 9 on the B string, I'm stretching the G string to get that note. So we get this. Now, the first question to you is, are you able to do this cleanly and accurately? Play along with me and let me know in the comments if this is something you're able to do or if it's something you have difficulty with. So drop it in the comments. We'll find out where we're all at today. So it's not a problem if you guys can't do this. That's why you're here. You're here to learn about bending. So let's go. Hopefully, that should be a fairly easy task. We're going to do the opposite now, where we're going to start on 9 on the B string. We'll then play 11 on the G string back to 9 on our G string again. So we have this. And for this, we're going to play the same thing, but we're going to bend, we're going to release, and then get our 9 to get this. Now, that's a little more challenging because here we don't have the same setup, but it's much the same idea. But you guys can see what's going on here. We have a way of playing this same melody, this business of... The big difference here is not so much the melody itself, but it's what's going on getting from this note to this note, or from this note to this note. We have our first question, our first comment in from Block 18 saying, no, I always go sharp. I'm gonna start that up because that's a really good observation. We're gonna address that a little bit later on. So stay put for that because we're gonna talk about that as we go, how you can easily fix your pitch issues. It's actually a very simple thing and it's nowhere near as complicated as you might think. And it's not to do with muscle memory, just throwing that out there. So what we're doing here is when we play this melody with a bend rather than with discrete notes, we're reducing a pitch glide, a smooth transition from here to hear, and this is part of what makes the guitar so great, is our ability to do this. Now, without going on the whole "the guitar is so great" thing, I will take a second and just dunk on our favorite instrument, because the guitar might be the worst designed instrument in the whole world. It's like, as far as like ergonomic design, it's pretty pants, but it is relatively cheap compared to, say, like cellos or saxophones. It's portable in a way that a piano isn't. It can play chords in a way that a violin can't or a saxophone can't, and it can also do this. Can't do that on a piano. So it's really cool for that reason. Now, this bend thing is a huge part of what makes guitar such a successful lead instrument, because what we're able to do is we're able to mimic the way that a human voice sounds as it glides from note to note. It's a really cool and interesting sound, and it behooves us to get this right. So let's start with the first and most obvious thing, which is, how do you bend in tune? How do you make your bends sound right, for want of a better word? Well, the first thing is, I kind of cruelly set you guys up. I didn't really set you up to fail, but I didn't exactly set you up for success with that previous example, because in order to bend in tune, it helps to have context. So bending in tune to what is the question? Well, it's normally in tune to a song or to a backing track or in tune to other musicians you're playing with. So the first point with this, and the most important point, is when you're doing this stuff, you should do it in context. You should play along with a backing track. You should play maybe along with one of our Lick Library backing tracks. We've got loads of them. Or you should learn a song. You should learn a song that has some bends that you like, and you should try playing along and see if you can get that in tune. But bending a tune is commonly taught as muscle memory. You remember how far you have to bend in order to create an in-tune bend. That is very broadly the case, but it's not really the case. What's actually going on here is, in order to bend in tune, we need to have a technique that allows us to react quickly in real time to the pitch that we're creating. Now, I'm going to use the analogy of elite violinists here, right? And I remember reading an interview with an elite violinist, or watching an interview rather. I can't remember what their name was, but an elite violin player, where they were talking about playing in tune. And the lesson was actually on skill learning, which is something I'm very interested in. But they talked about elite violinists, and they said what violinists are doing when they're playing in tune is not, and I repeat, not putting their fingers in the right place every time. It's close to the right place every time, but they haven't perfectly memorized the violin's fingerboard, so they know exactly where a C sharp is, for example, or exactly where a B is. What they do instead is, the best violin players are able to press a note. Do they call it fret a note? Finger a note, I guess. And they're able to react really quickly, like microscopically quickly, by rolling their finger one way or another. I'll show you one here on the close-up cam. By rolling their finger one way or another to correct the tuning before we even notice what's going on. Now, this is how bending in tune works. We get broadly in the ballpark, but then we allow our technique to micro-adjust so that we can get ourselves perfectly in tune. This requires a few things. It requires, first of all, a keen ear that you can train by just doing this more. The more you do this, the better you're gonna get it. But it also requires a technique that allows us to make these micro adjustments. And this is one of the most common issues that I see when I talk to guitar players about this sort of thing, is we're often told when it's time to bend, what we should do is we should lock our fingers in place. Lock your fingers and transfer force from the wrist, the big powerful muscles of the wrist and the upper arm, into the string with locked fingers, and that will get you to where you're going to go. It will. It's a good way to maximize force transfer into the string, but we're not trying to maximize force transfer. We're trying to bend in tune. That's the task. So what we're better off doing is having fingers that are firm, but not completely locked. They shouldn't feel like you're trying to crush the guitar's neck. They should feel comparatively loose compared to the tightest that you can make them, but there should also be, you know, there should be enough tension in there, just a wee tiny bit of tension, or enough strength in there, I would say, rather, to get you to roughly where the note is roughly where the note is in the ballpark, and then you allow some little creep of tension or reduction of tension in the left hand to massage the bend into tune. And the more you do this, the better you're going to get at it. So what I want to do is I want to do some quick experiments with you. We're going to do some bends, and we're going to compare the effect of bending with a very hardly, like very firm, locked set of fingers. We're just going to lock your fingers as tightly as you can and push up on the string and see how accurate that feels compared to a slightly less locked fingering, like a slightly less locked set of fingers, a little bit of looseness in the fingers, a little bit of slack that's going to allow us to massage the bend. Let's compare. I'm going to throw my backing track back on. We're going to be bending from fret number 11 on our G string up to fret number 13 on our G string. Let's start with locked fingers and see where it gets us. Locked fingers again. A little sharp that time. Locked fingers again. Very sharp that time. This time with looser fingers. Now I undershot there, but I was able to correct, and that's good. Looser fingers. Again, undershot and corrected. On the money that time. Overshot and corrected. So, this slightly looser fingering, let's say, this slightly looser finger grip is going to enable you to correct your bends in real time. Now, that is part of the technique of bending, but there's another thing we need, another very important thing, is we need to have a clear idea of what note we're trying to bend to. Now, this is something that I think folks sometimes miss, is that anytime we bend a note, we're going to another note. We're not just bending the string for the sake of it, we're bending the string to get the pitch to another pitch. Now for this, we're going to discuss a few options that we have in terms of how far we bend. So we're going to take that same bend again, but this time we're going to bend it and release it. And we can go a number of different distances here. So we have the option of going a whole tone, which is all the way up from 11 to 13. We can go a tone and a half, which is all the way up from 11 to 14. We could go a semitone, which is all the way just as far as 11 to 12. Or we could do less than a semitone. We could do a very small bend, which is somewhere in the realms of a microtone or a quarter tone. Let me show you the musical effect of each of these, along with my backing track. Let's start with the most common bend, which is the bend of a tone, where we bend from this fret and back down again. Holger's asking about, will you also talk about combining bending and vibrato? I most certainly will. Stick with us, we're definitely gonna get onto that. So, let's talk about this. So, real quick. We are going to go a semitone, a tone rather, two frets, our most common bend. Very common. Let's do it again. Let's go a tone and a half as far as this. Nice big sweeping bend. Let's just do a semitone. Far as that. And now a little microtone. All of these have their place musically. Let me show you them in context. That was a bad one. Let's do it again. Excluding that first example, that was just me overshooting, not for the sake of it, but just overshooting because humans make mistakes. All of those have very distinct musical effects, and being aware of where we're trying to bend to is a crucial part of being bending in tune, because what we're trying to do is we're trying to react to a sound that we're hearing in our head and being able to correct for that as we go with our bend. So what I want you to do with this in terms of like being better at bending in tune this way is have a clear mental image of the sound that you're trying to make. So what you might do with this is you might think about internally singing the note that you're trying to bend to. Now, this doesn't mean you have to sing it out loud. It just means having some kind of mental sound picture of the note you're trying to get to. Now, a good way to do this is to learn classic solos. Now, for this, the reason this is good is because you know what the classic solo is supposed to sound like. And if you know what it's meant to sound like, then you'll know if you're getting it right or not. To this end, I want to take a quick second and show you one of the classic solos that I would heartily recommend taking a look at, because it's not technically terribly challenging, but there's some really great bends in there. This is the solo from Killer Queen from our Learn to Play Queen series. This is Michael Caswell teaching. I'm going to throw this on screen. Let me just add this to the stage real quick. Give me a moment. We'll throw that in there. So this is Michael Caswell teaching Killer Queen. I'm going to bring myself in this shot too, because I want to be here as well. Let's take a watch. This is one of the solos that you are... It's one of the solos that you get full tuition of as part of your Lick Library membership. So if you're not a member, maybe today's the day. But let's check out Michael playing the solo. And some more licks further on down the line. Now, I will never get sick of watching Michael Caswell play the guitar. And if you want to learn that song, that's a really great choice because we know what it's supposed to sound like. You have a clear mental picture of the sound that you're trying to make, and this is great for getting your bends in tune. And also, you get a backing track to play along to, so you can double reference that way. It's such a great song, man. It's just absolutely killer. Another one we'll talk about in a second. We've got a great recent one from Sam Bell that we're going to throw your way to, because we love a bit of Sammy B. So anyway, let's talk more about some of the other aspects of bending. Now, somebody mentioned bending and vibrato, and we're going to talk about that today. We did talk about this a little bit in our vibrato session last week, but you know, Holger is asking about bending and vibrato, so let's just quickly head that off as we go. Now, bends and vibrato, they go together very well, but they seem to be one of these things that a lot of folks struggle with, because I get loads of questions about it. Now, it does take a bit of development, the whole bending and vibrato thing, but this ties back into my contention about having a slightly looser finger grip compared to, you know, the absolute tightest of fingers. So in order to do bends and vibrato accurately, what we're trying to do here is we're trying to bend to a pitch and then release the note and let it come back to the pitch that we've bent to. Now, it's a little bit like vibrato in reverse, and I think this is what trips a lot of folks up. I'll show you what I'm talking about. Let's go to these cameras very quickly. Let's try to. Apparently, we'll go to all the cameras all at once. Let's go to this camera real quick. So, if we go back to our same pitches where we're playing this 11 bending up to 13, with our bends and our vibrato, what we might get is we might be tempted to do something like this, where we bend up and then we apply more bend on top to get the vibrato, which might sound a little awkward like this. It's a bit of a strange sound, and I think it's where a lot of folks struggle with this, but in reality, the bending and vibrato thing is probably better thought of as bending to pitch, then releasing the pitch and allowing it to come back up to the pitch that we originally bent to. So it's a partial release. It might sound more like this. Now, this is a fine opportunity to make a vibrato sound that isn't the same as when we do our traditional guitar vibrato. Because our guitar vibrato, when we do like vibrato with a fretted note, man, we can only go up. And it's a cool sound, but we can only raise the pitch. It's a good sound, but with bends, we can lower the pitch. And this is one of the things that Brian May did, like par excellence, is he'd hit these big pre-bends and do this vibrato that sang under the note. So what we might get is something like this. Mm-hmm. Now that is the way to think about bending a vibrato, I think, is think about it as just a series of rhythmic releases, but we don't have to release all the way. This is kind of crucial. So if we're doing a huge bend, we don't necessarily want to bring it all the way back to the original pitch. Now we can do that if we want to sound like Zakk Wylde. Cool sound, you know, nothing wrong with sound like Zakk Wylde. You know, let me tell you, big fan of Zakk, but we might get, if we do a full release, we might get something like this. That's a fine sound, but it's very situational. You would probably only do this when you're playing some very aggressive music. For most stuff, we're better off with a partial release of our bend. How far? Well, that's for you to decide, and that's something you can find out a little more on by checking out our vibrato lecture that we did last week on the Lick Library YouTube channel. If you're not subscribed to us, drop us a subscribe. We do lives like this all the time. It's real good. So anyway, Marcin is here. Marcin, hey, great to see you, man. And a lovely compliment. Thank you very much. Good to have you on board. Marcin's a great guitar player, a regular on our Monday night streams as well. I think the most regular of our regulars, but always lovely to have Marcin on board. So that's the bending vibrato thing. If you have more questions about this, we'll go further. Here's one from Helmet Strap. Says, instead of correcting, I was automatically cheating by using vibrato. Is this a bad habit? Well, I mean, I think it depends. Me personally, I would want to be able to have a bend hang without vibrato. Personally, I want to be able to have it hang without the vibrato in the air, because sometimes you want that sweep up into a bend without necessarily without necessarily applying the vibrato. You want to be able to do both. You may not want to be able to do both. You may only ever want to play bends with vibrato, and if that's the case and you're enjoying what you're doing with that, rock on. But for me, I'd want to be able to get it just so without. Now, a real classic example of this is the Is This Love solo by John Sykes. I don't have that, but I do have my 87 ballad backing track queued up, which I'm going to throw on because it's my favorite, right? And it's basically Is This Love. It's not quite the same, but it's similar. So I'll throw it on. I'll show you what I'm talking about. So this has this absolutely fabulous bend from, we're in the key of E for this, absolutely fantastic bend from an A note. Oh, is it up there? Yeah, it is there. From an A note all the way up to a B note in the key of E minor, and it just hangs forever, and it sounds absolutely fabulous. It's a bit like this. So that lovely big bend might be... Notice we're letting those bends hang in the air before we stack the vibrato on. Now, that's a stylistic choice as much as anything else. So I would want to be able to do that. So I would be doing some correction practice so that I can kind of get used to bending as in tune as I possibly can. Now, having a tuner handy can help for this. I don't think we necessarily need to obsess about getting our notes absolutely on the tuner needle, because like tuning is kind of contextual anyway. So with this, the most in tune version of a B is gonna depend on whether it's over an E chord or over a G chord or over a B chord. They're gonna be different kinds of B. Now we're not gonna get into microtones and sweetened tunings, but sometimes the tuning that is on the money with the tuner needle in the middle is not the one that sounds the best. Sometimes we want to be a little bit sharp, sometimes a little bit flat. It's contextual. It's more about using your ears. So this is where learning killer like solos that you love kind of comes in with this. Another thing is you can learn melodies from singers that you like, especially singers before auto-tune who had great intonation but maybe weren't necessarily bang on in tune. But a tuner can help. Sometimes it's exactly what we want to be completely on the tuning needle, but let's not forget that 12-tone even temperament is it's a compromise anyway. It's an it's kind of an agreed upon, you know, lesser of all the evils. So, you know, while the tuning needle is important and do play your guitar in tune, sometimes a bend that is just slightly flat is actually a better bend, and sometimes a bend that's just slightly sharp is a better bend. We have to use our ears for this. That's perhaps not always the case. Not an excuse for bending out of tune. Your bend should sound good as its priority. So, leads me to the next thing we can talk about, which is the timing of our bends and how fast we get there and how fast we get out of there and what we do at the end of the bend. So, let's go back to that Whitesnake example here. So, we have a few ways that we can approach our bend's conclusion, if that makes sense. So if we go from this A up to this B, we have a few ways that we can get there. We can bend very slowly up to pitch, we can bend very quickly up to pitch, we can bend very slowly and then rapidly move up in like that kind of curve. We can do the opposite where we go very quickly up and then slowly meet the pitch. Let me show you what they all sound like. So in the key B minor, there's a nice slow bend in. There's a quick one. Let's do a slow one again. Very slow. Let's go again, quick. Let's do a combination of speed and slow. There we had a slow release. Let's do quick up and slow release. Quick up and slow release. Let's do the opposite, slow up and quick release. Oh. That can sound very cool too. Now, there is no recipe for this that says, you know, speed should be this and you should go up quickly here, you should go down quickly here. It's a matter of taste, but I think the most important thing with this is it starts with awareness. It starts with actually acknowledging that bends happen in the time domain as well as in the pitch domain. And it's not enough just to go, oh, well, I started here and then I got to the next note. You know, that's fine. That's what bends look like on tab, and that makes sense. But there is way more to it than that, which is, I guess, where tab is a little bit deficient when it comes to learning classic solos, where there are lots of bends, because you need to hear what the bend sounds like. It's not just a question of start here, finish here. It's all about the arc and the curvature of the bend. There is more to that. Lovely comment from the bane of your existence, who is not the bane of my existence right now, let me tell you. It says, I'm late to the party. How do you get that sustain and that tone? Well, the tone, I can tell you, the tone is a Maybach Convair into a Victory Super Kraken. That's the tone. Impulse response is 4x12s in the greenback. And then I've got some reverb and some delay, but the way I get that sustain in particular is I'm not hitting the strings particularly hard for this. I'm, you know, not tickling them, but we're allowing the string to breathe, so it's not slapping off the frets. That does help with the sustain a little bit. But yeah, JM Guitar Tuition says, yes, never a truer word said, re-tab and expression. For sure. I mean, tab is important, tab is cool, but it's a nice shortcut, but there's nothing beats having something explained to you or discovering it yourself. Discovering it yourself is kind of the long way around, but let me give you an example of this, right? We're gonna do another classic solo real quick. This is one from Sam Bell. It's a new addition to the Lick Library website. It's one of my absolute favorite guitar solos. It's a real sleeper from the 80s. This is the solo from Alone by Heart. And let me show you what I'm talking about. So first of all, some really cool bends in here, including some Guthrie style compound bends, which are really good fun. Let me show you what Sammy's got in store for us. I'm gonna bring myself in here.
Most of the solo starts off here in this E flat minor pentatonic position one. So it's useful to reference that as we learn this. So 14th fret on the B string, we're going to start out with two bends, basically pick it twice. So you bend up, and then you re-pick it at the top of the bend and release. At the end of the release, you go to your 11th fret and a B. Then bend up again on the 14th fret. The bend is a tone bend, of course, because it's within the pentatonic scale.
Now, we could sit and listen to Sam do that all day, but the important thing here is not so much that Sam's teaching you a great solo, but when you're listening to someone teach you a solo like this, you're listening to someone teach you. You hear every time he plays that expression. Every time he plays in that bend, you get to hear what it sounds like, and you get some sonic reference that you don't get just from, like, you know, tabs on Tinternet. But we're not here to advertise our courses. We are a bit, but, you know, even still, I think the membership's great. I think you guys should pick one up. That's all I'm saying. But anyway, so on that note, we have an arc to our bend. There is one more thing that I want to talk to you guys about. So this is perhaps a little bit deeper and a bit more subtle when it comes to your bending, but perhaps the most important aspect of your bending, I think at least, is what is going on with your right hand. What's going on with your right hand? Now, your right hand is, it's an interesting beast, because you might think the right hand's not involved in the bending. Well, it kind of is, because the way we strike our string is really going to determine how our bend sounds. Whether a bend is smooth and singing, or whether it's howling and kind of, you know, the harmonics in the bend start to modulate and start to scream. Why tell when you can show? So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to go to this two hands cam with a little Star Wars wipe. So what you'll be able to see here is I'm going to play with different touches on my right hand on the John Sykes bend. Again, that E minor bend thing. And you'll see how, depending upon how I angle my pick, how hard I hit the string, the bend is going to sound different, i.e. the way the note sounds and the way the note evolves is going to change depending upon the way I hit it. So let's take a listen. Let's start here. It's a very soft touch. Let's do a more aggressive touch. We can hear the harmonics start to evolve there. That's really digging in. You can hear that kind of sound. Let's do it with a very gentle touch. Let's switch to the bridge pick and take a listen again. That almost sounds like a wah being caught. Let's play gently. Let's play hard. Loads of fun to be had there, and not something folks necessarily spend enough time considering, but there's another aspect to this, which is not just what's going on with the right hand touch, but also what are you doing with your right hand to help your bend be as good and as clear as it can be. Now, what you might notice with me when I'm doing this, when I'm hitting these big bends, take a close look at what I'm doing with my thumb and with these three fingers here. Right? A little cheat that's going on. There are no cheats in music. If it sounds good, it's good. You don't get points deducted for doing stuff like this. So, let me show you. This is a little thing that I picked up from a friend of mine in college, and it's really cool. If I go... Can you see that? Look at where my third finger, my second finger is, and look at where my thumb is. I'm making a little tunnel for the string that I'm playing on. What that allows me to do is it allows me to focus very clearly on, beg your pardon, on getting the bend right without worrying so much about string muting with my left hand, because my right hand is taking care of the muting. Now, that's a little trick that I don't think gets spoken about enough. This requires a little bit of practice, but not as much practice as you'd think. So that's kind of what I'm talking about. So anyway, here are a few more questions that we've had come in. We're going to address those as we go. Really great comment from Daryl Queen. Daryl Queen says, right or wrong, for everything in music, So what's right and what's wrong for everything in music should be based on your intentions rather than a specific dogma. Oh man, for sure, for sure. Our friend Casper Steenkamp has just come in with the question, can you explain techniques for muting adjacent strings? Sure can, I'll do it again. Wanna see me mute strings? Wanna see me do it again? What we get here, this is my little trick for this. Now, you can mute with the inside of your fingers on this hand. So if I'm playing my G string, I can use the tip of this finger, my third finger, or my other fingers at least as well, rather, to mute the D string. I can use the inside of this finger to mute the B string, but my preferred method is just to use the fingers of this hand. So I'm gonna play, that's my right hand, rather. So I'm gonna play this G string bend. And then notice what I've done is I've got my thumb handling all of the low strings. And then I have my middle ring and pinky fingers on my right hand, muting every string that's not the G string. If I do this, the only string that comes out is the G string. And this is actually quite quick to get in and out of. You'll notice where my pick is. I haven't ditched the pick and done this. The pick is still in my hand. I'm just resting my thumb on all the strings I'm not using. So that's how I like to do that stuff. And I'm quite good at getting in and out of this quickly. And it's just something that takes a little bit of practice, but it makes your bends super clean. So what I might do is this. I'll show you it with some more involved examples. Now I'm doing this literally all of the time. Now you can also use this for the Gary Moore style bends where you bray a couple of strings and then one of them just starts to come out like this. The right hand is really useful for that string muting business. I think it's like, it's such an underrated little tip, and like I do this literally all the time. It just takes a bit of practice to get in and out of. So real good question there, I think. Here's another one very quickly from our friend R. Mark Chizek. Great name. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Says, I appreciate what you do. I appreciate you too, man. Thank you very much. Been working my bends and vibrato for the last couple of weeks. I really appreciate that. Says, is it possible to request you all do a backing track for Slow Train by Joe Bonamassa? I use the one for Slow Gin all the time. Well, you know, request received. We're going to try our best for that. We are making a whole bunch of new backing tracks. Maybe we'll put that on the list. That's a good shout. So our man Stu Shields is in the comment section. I'm going to put it to him after this stream. We'll see what we can do. It's definitely one that should be on our list. So one from Timothy Appling says, question, I know you're light on the fretboard, but do you get thick calluses in your fingertips from lots of bending? For sure. I got some really gnarly calluses on the go here. Not just on my fretting fingers, but also on the palm of my hand as well. But that's from lifting. That's not from fretting. But yeah, what you can see is, like, hopefully you guys will be able to see this. I don't think I have the autofocus on this. I think it's manual focus, so you might not be able to see, but I have got some pretty gnarly calluses on there. Because let's be honest, even if you're not pressing very hard, which you probably shouldn't be, you know, we should be aiming for a light touch on the fretboard, even if you're not fretting like super super hard, you're still touching a sharp, not sharp, but like a bit of metal, a thin piece of metal wire held at tension with your fingertips. That's gonna get pretty rough on your fingers pretty quick. So you'll still get those big old calluses. I would suggest probably the bigger the better. Calluses are good. Here's a really cool one. Our friend from Mauricio says, fantastic tip, muting the, strung with the thumb, I'm guessing muting with the thumb. Hey man, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. So we did have one more question I promised we were going to get to, which is, oh, we've been over it. Our friend Helmut, Block 18, about the sharp flat thing. So we've been over that. So if you have any more questions, guys, let me know. Oh, here's a really good one. I noticed you bent down. At what point do you choose to do that? Well, it's more about, at this point, it's more about hearing a melody in my head, and the melody might have this boo kind of thing, boo, as opposed to this boop kind of, or beep boo. And maybe I'll hear the melody as going downwards, and if I hear that in my head as I'm playing it, I'll get that by bending up and pulling down. However, what you might also know, what you might also be referring to as, I've just realized this as we're going, you might be referring to this business where sometimes I'll pull in this direction, sometimes I'll push in this direction. Here's the rule for this, right? The rule of thumb is on these strings, that is the wound strings, we pull towards the floor. Because if we push, we don't have enough fretboard to really execute any lovely big bends. The D string, maybe, but it's generally best to pull the D string rather than to push it. On the highest two strings, the B string and the E string, we push. That is, we go in this direction with our bends and with our vibrato. I think a special niggle of mine is when some folks do pull vibrato on the E string. It just drives me crazy because you'll always hear this little slipping off the fret. I don't know how anybody gets any purchase doing that. Even pull vibrato on the B string kind of drives me crazy. I've got quite a lot of clearance on this guitar. I will always do push vibrato on those. Always push vibrato on these two strings. On the G string, however, all bets are off. Sometimes we push, sometimes we pull. You can do either. For this, what I like to do is I like to pull with my first finger. I like to push with my third finger. Second finger, I'll do whatever. I think that's just a question of strength. I feel like I'm stronger pulling on the string with my first finger, whereas my third finger I can push, if that makes sense. Because I've got more fingers to help with the support. So that's the rule. Pull, down towards the floor on these three strings. Always push towards the ceiling on these strings. This one, it can go either way. If you want a hard and fast rule, I would say push for this rather than push for this rather than pull for this. But I know Steve Lukather likes to pull on this one, so, and he's Steve Lukather, so who am I to criticize? Anyway, one more question here from our friend Gordy Mac. It says, does scale length affect the ease of bending? I'm going to say maybe. Here's the reason why, because this is what you'd call a Gibson scale guitar. It is a 24¾-inch scale. If we compare that to a 25-inch scale guitar, if I have a 25½-inch scale guitar, or one of my PRS, which is 25-inch scale, a Fender scale guitar will have a longer scale length, i.e. a greater distance between the nut and the bridge, or the nut and the saddle. That will, with the same string gauge, at the same tuning, it will be tighter on the Fender scale guitar than it will on the Gibson scale guitar. So yes, that will make bending more challenging, but only because the string is tighter, not because of the scale length on its own. However, it's common practice to put, say, 9s on a Fender style guitar, 10s on a Gibson style guitar. 10s on a Gibson style guitar will be fractionally heavier than 9s on a Fender scale guitar, if that makes sense. It's just, so ultimately, what I guess I'm getting at here is that the scale length on its own doesn't impact the bending ease. The string tension does. And scale length is one of the things that impacts string tension. However, an independent factor from string tension that makes bends feel easier is fret height. So if you have tall frets generally feel easier to bend. But with that comes the caveat that you have to fret lightly, otherwise you might bend them out of tune. So I like tall frets. This guitar has vintage frets on it right now because that's how it came. I'm going to put tall frets on it at some point, but I'm enjoying these ones as they are. But as a rule of thumb, I prefer tall frets so I can get under them and bend a little more easily. Here's one more question on this. What about the action of the guitar in order to get a clear bending? I'm guessing that's clear. I know what you're trying to say there. So the action of the guitar, for my money, only has to be high enough that you can bend as far as you're going to bend without it choking when you apply vibrato or when you hit hard. For this guitar and most of my guitars, I have an action of 1 millimeter at the 12th fret on the high E string, 1.5 millimeters at the 12th fret on the low E string, and just as smooth a gradient as I can get on there, which is quite low. But if your fretwork is good, you should be okay, if that makes sense. So I would experiment with that. What I would do is I would take the strings that you bend on the most and I would bend them, make sure that you can get at least a tone with some vibrato out of them, that is a full frets bend with vibrato, then you're probably good. You might find there's maybe one area where you have to avoid bending, if that makes sense, but you know, we shouldn't necessarily have that. So load of great questions and comments coming in here. I really do appreciate it. I do just want to quickly circle back and get back on one that I missed, if I can find it. You know, I think we're gonna have to do that another time, because guys, we are running out of time. I want to take a quick second and thank you so much for coming on board. It has been a pleasure having you. My name is Nick Jennison for licklibrary.com. If you've enjoyed what we're doing here today, you want more lessons, you can head to licklibrary.com, where you're gonna get more lessons than you could possibly get through in a lifetime. But don't worry, because we also have guided learning paths and we have one-to-one support to help you make sure that you're getting the lessons that you need at the time when you need them. So I'm going to play some more. My name is Nick Jennison for Lick Library. I will see you guys next time, whenever that happens to be. Hopefully not too soon. I think we're going to make this a regular occurrence, because I do love doing these live streams. We'll see you guys later. Take care of yourselves. In the meantime, let's pretend to be John Sykes a little bit more. See you guys around.